Today, the topic of our presentation is Yersiniosis. Yersiniosis is a chronic infection typically due to Yersinia enterocolitica, and it represents a growing problem in the United States and in California in particular. Why we're talking about Yersiniosis in our clinic? Well, because on an annual basis we see approximately 40 or 50 new patients with chronic Yersiniosis, and typically this infection is linked to various musculoskeletal problems. So what is Yersiniosis? It is a foodborne chronic infection which typically caused by Yersinia enterocolitica and to a lesser degree by Yersinia pseudotuberculosis. And again, it's a chronic infection due to these microorganisms. Obviously, Yersinia comes from the environment, from the nature. This microorganism can be found in the gastrointestinal tract of numerous large animals, such as cattle, deer, pigs, and birds. Yersinia enterocolitica typically found in porcine intestine, and it's an infection which is harmful to humans. The initial infection presents as a diarrhea and inflammation in the small intestine. Humans contract Yersinia with contaminated food or water. And again, the most common sources include undercooked pork, pig intestines or porcine intestines, and raw chitterlings. So, what are the signs and symptoms? We should separate an acute Yersiniosis and chronic Yersiniosis. Typically, the acute infection with Yersinia enterocolitica presents as a typical food poisoning with fever, chills, watery diarrhea, and nausea. So the chronic Yersiniosis represent a completely different animal. So typically, patients who have chronic Yersiniosis, they complain about frequent bouts of right lower quadrant abdominal pain, and frequently they're diagnosed with pseudoappendicitis. So this right lower quadrant abdominal pain is also frequently associated with right-sided lower back pain and right-sided hip pain. In our clinic, we frequently see association between chronic Yersiniosis and various degrees of scoliosis, as well as various problems associated with sternoclavicular joints. Sometimes it's pain, sometimes it's deformity. What is interesting that majority of the patients with Yersiniosis, they have pain predominantly over the right side of the body. It has been described in numerous articles that Yersiniosis also has a close association with autoimmune thyroid disease, such as Hashimoto's thyroiditis. Can we expect to see on images? So a typical presentation of chronic Yersiniosis is ileocecal valve or distal ileum thickening on either abdominal CT scan or MRI. When you see a patient with a musculoskeletal condition or other chronic inflammatory situations, so how do you choose who needs to be tested for Yersiniosis? So this slide actually talks about most common conditions which we see in our practice, which are associated with Yersiniosis, chronic Yersiniosis, obviously. So we're talking about inflammatory arthritis and a subset of patients with rheumatoid arthritis in particular, patients with ankylosing spondylitis, frequently dealing with chronic Yersiniosis. Based on my estimation, approximately 5 to 10% of people who are HLA-B27 positive do carry Yersinia enterocolitica, and they do have problems with chronic Yersiniosis. Patients with psoriatic arthritis, patients who have irritable bowel syndrome with chronic diarrhea, obviously patients who have chronic right lower quadrant abdominal pain without any detectable problems, patients with chronic right hip pain and right-sided lower back pain. Also, there is a high prevalence of chronic Yersiniosis in patients with ulcerative colitis, patients who have Crohn's disease, patients who have scoliosis, Hashimoto, thyroiditis, and also patients who have iron overload disease and hemochromatosis. So it is well recognized that patients who have Yersiniosis can demonstrate positive Lyme serology due to cross-reactivity with borrelia burgdorferi, and it is my recommendation to check patients who have atypical Lyme disease presentation for the presence of chronic Yersiniosis. So how do we test for chronic Yersiniosis? We do stool culture for Yersinia if diarrhea presence, so you can do stool PCR as well for both Yersinia enterocolitica and Yersinia pseudotuberculosis. But most commonly, the diagnosis is based on combination of clinical presentation and elevated levels of IgM or IgG or and IgA antibodies to Yersinia enterocolitica. This test is commercially available through LabCorp and Quest. So in our clinic, we're also using thermography as a screening tool, and quite frequently patients with chronic Yersiniosis, they have abnormal appearance of the surface thermographic picture around right lower quadrant. One of them you can see on this particular slide. What's the therapy for chronic Yersiniosis? So first of all, antibiotics, anti-inflammatory drugs, as well as botanicals, probiotics, and dietary modifications. So antibiotic therapy includes tetracyclines, azithromycin, trimetoprim sulfamethoxazole, known as Bactrim, fluoroquinolones in rare situations, as well as third and fourth generation of cephalosporins. One thing which I need to mention that the therapy of Yersiniosis is a long-term therapy, and specific duration of the therapy needs to be defined on case-by-case basis. We also like using anti-inflammatory drugs such as sulfasalazine or 5-aminosalicylic acid, and we have a very good success rate by combining antibiotic and anti-inflammatory therapy. So let's talk about nutraceuticals, more specifically botanicals. We can use botanicals alone, we can use botanicals in combination with pharmaceuticals as well. So what is known about botanicals? Well, there are a very, very strong database supporting the use of arjun, berberine, guava leaf, lamatium, neem to treat chronic Yersiniosis. Typically, we like combining several botanicals together. The second tier drugs represent alpha-lipoic acid. One thing which I need to mention is that Yersinia thrives on iron, and alpha-lipoic acid is an iron binder, it's iron chelating agent, and it has a definitive place in the therapy of Yersiniosis. And there are quite a few other botanicals which we're using in our practice, including anamo, ashoka, cat's claw, nutraceutical colloidal silver, olive leaf extract, and oregano oil. Again, the specific combination of nutraceuticals and botanicals needs to be determined on case-to-case basis. In addition to botanicals, we're using various probiotics, including, for example, high-dose Bacillus coagulans and Saccharomyces boulardii, as well as dietary modifications, including low-carb diet and definitely low-iron diet. So the question which comes up quite frequently in our clinic is how to avoid Yersiniosis or how to diminish the risk of contracting Yersinia infection. And so typically I recommend to avoid eating raw or undercooked pork, including various products such as salami, for example, or bacon. Store food properly, consume only pasteurized dairy products, and obviously wash your hands when preparing food.